of the Power Coalition, where I serve as the program director and the community organizer. You know, tonight is very important. It's an important night, not because we're going to have all of our candidates and they agree to join us. It's not just important because we all work so hard to create this space for you. But what makes it important is you, everyone in this room. Tonight is about us. Tonight is about the people of Geneva. Yes, we are all excited. How many of you have already early voted? Okay, so we still have a couple of more days to do that. So tonight, on behalf of the Power Coalition, I invite you to listen. I invite you to learn. I invite you to be engaged so that when you do go to the polls, you are voting for someone who will value your voice, someone who will listen to your concerns, and someone who will be willing to work with you to address the issues that you face each and every day in your community. So I'm going to ask you again, New Orleans, are you ready? Yes! Thank you. My name is Tanaj Jones, and coming up next, we will have Michael Robinson with Jericho Road.
And put a chip in my pocket. All right, everybody. So my role tonight is to help set the focus. And I know that this is probably the 18th mayoral forum, and probably the 69th, district forum that you might have heard about in the papers. But we want to set this one to be different. Like you said, we are part of the Power Coalition. This has been put on by any set of organizations. Our specific goal is to get people who are not usually involved in democracy, who are not usually involved in the system that has influenced their lives, and we try to get people involved in the system so that the system responds and respects and responds to them. So this is actually part of a process. Everyone say process.
Process.
That's right. So this is not just a one-off form. But we have been doing something called G-O-T-V. All right. So it means get out the vote. We are part of a nonpartisan coalition. We don't favor any particular candidate. I love it in organizing, we say no permanent enemies and no permanent allies. We hold everybody accountable. So since the summer, since the primary, since people have declared to run for office, what we have been doing is that we have been doing canvassing. Right? Walking the streets, walking District B and E and Algiers and Uptown. We have been knocking on doors and we've been trying to encourage those that don't frequently vote to come out and vote because it matters. Also, we have been doing phone banking. How many have ever received a call from somebody asking to come out and vote? All right? Now, you know, being on the other side of it, you know, nobody should hate the cause, but now I love to see that there have been hundreds of people involved calling their neighbors, calling people who live in the neighborhood, people they don't even know, and trying to encourage them to come out and vote. Now, what makes tonight different than other forums is that we want, instead of the candidates kind of delivering their platform, instead of the candidates telling you they wanna what they wanna do, we wanna hold them accountable to the people's agenda. So when you look on the back, you're gonna see these copies of the people's agenda. And the people's agenda was not something that was just birthed out of somebody's imagination. We held right down the street, we held a rally where we listened to people, we talked to people, different organizations that are involved in the coalition. Went into the neighborhoods, asking people, what is it that you need? What is it that matters to you? What keeps you up at night? And so tonight, we have questions set up for the candidates, asking them, what is your response to this? How are you actually going to respond to the needs of us? Tonight is about we, the people. government is set up to serve the people. You know, if you open up the Constitution, right, there's a little preamble, and it says that we're going to form this government because we agree that government should benefit who? Should government only benefit the supporters of the candidate? Should government only benefit those who have money and those who have influence? Government should benefit the people. And I want you to keep this very important moment in your mind when you listen to the candidates today, and they're telling you what they're going to do in accordance to the people's agenda. We're coming up, starting this Saturday, we're going to celebrate the 300th year of New Orleans being born and being around. And we're at a critical point because in all our neighborhoods, New Orleans has seen a lot of change the past 18 years, amen? You know, I have a 10-year-old son, and he was born after Katrina. And I'm worried about his future in the city. And what I want to hear is a vision from the candidates, not just platitudes, not just fixing the streets and rubbing babies on the backside and kissing them on the cheek, whatever they say. But we want to hear actually what are they going to do about our economic prosperity? How are they going to include us, those who have been left out? How are they going to make a way of opportunity for everyone, not just those who normally benefit from the system? So tonight, listen up, listen closely, because this is about us, we the people. Amen? Amen.
Next, coming to the stage is the Executive Director of Bell, Mr. Cyndi Nguyen, who is going to do our roll call.
All right. My name is Cyndi Nguyen. I'm the Executive Director by day and MC hype man by night. So, that's how we're gonna do tonight, y'all. So it's a pleasure to be here tonight. I'm really happy that folks are coming out just to really hear what's going on. You're gonna be listening to the candidates. Our role have been always been trying to get people out to vote. We're this, I mean, we're nonpartisan as well, right? Our job is to make sure people are reminded, educated, and mobilized to vote. And I think that's it's been quite a challenge this year, I'm not gonna lie, it's been hard. But to see people here tonight, it's a big deal. So first we wanna see we got anybody from New Orleans in the house, New Orleans East in the house. All right. Gentilly in the house. How about Algiers? Anybody in Algiers? Come on, y'all. Come on. Uptown. Anybody from Uptown?
You know.
Yeah. How about the Silver Bowl? Anybody from the Silver Bowl? All right. Who else? Citrus City? We got Citrus City. That's good. Who else we have? Tremaine. Bayou St. John. I see my people here. We have any teachers in the house? Any teachers? Come on, we have to see no teachers. Any working families? Come on, working families. Where y'all at? All right, working families. Right here. Good. Who else? Any physicians in the house? No, okay.
You know what?
We gotta get parents in the house. Any parents? I have a new parent. I know I'm proud of you. I get to raise my hand, you know? Any grandparents in the house? Any grandparents? No, it's important for y'all to be here because, obviously, you're born for the future of New Orleans, which is for our kids, right? So I'm really happy that y'all are all here. And I'm just happy that we're here to listen. So, I'm gonna invite the next person to come up to introduce our moderator. Who's introducing moderator? Tanaj, who you at? Y'all feeling good though? Come on, we got. Okay, good. You know, later we'll be talking about acting about really, really amazing, important things, so I just wanna make sure that y'all are awake and ready to go. So.
and what she's doing with the Deandra Johnson-Burrell, who will be moderating and facilitating for this evening. Deandra Johnson-Burrell is a program officer for the New Orleans team with the W.K. Kellogg Foundation in Battle Creek, Michigan. In this role, she helps develop programming priorities, reviews and recommends proposals for funding, maintains strong relationships with grant seekers and grantees, provides leadership and oversight for the on-ground execution of program efforts, and designs and implements national grant initiatives, place-based work, and multi-year projects that affect systemic change and program strategy in New Orleans. Prior to joining the foundation, Johnson Burrell was the executive director at our Orleans Public Education Network, who we all know as OPEN, where she effectively developed organizational structure and built the capacity of the organization to serve as a leading voice for authentic community engagement and influence in New Orleans around education reform. Prior to this, she served as the director of education and community investment at the Greater New Orleans Foundation, director of programs for Urban League of Greater New Orleans, and director of policy and research for Georgia Partnership for Excellence in Education in Atlanta. Johnson Burrell is a former W.K. Kellogg Community Leadership Fellow. She has held a number of board positions, including board chair for Kids Rethink New Orleans Schools, advisory board member of the Education Research Alliance at Tulane University, advisory board member of National Transforming Early Childhood Community Systems, founding board member of Crescent City Schools, founding board member of Orleans Public Education Network, and advisory board member for Breakthrough New Orleans. Ms. Burrell obtained her MPA with a focus in public policy and nonprofit manager from New York University, Robert F. Wagner Graduate School of Public Service. She also holds a Bachelor of Arts in Political Science from the University of California, Berkeley. I present to you Ms. Deandra Johnson Burrell, our moderator for this evening.
Good evening, family.
Good evening.
All right, let's get to the business at hand. All of that nice stuff she said, what's most important, what I'm most proud of, is being a lady in New Orleans. So let's bring our first candidates to the podium, Councilmember James Gray and Cyndi Nguyen. All right, as you all are seated, I'm going to go over the rules and we'll dive right in. Each candidate has a 2-minute opening statement. Four organizational questions will be asked, and if we have time, we'll take 2 questions from the audience. That's time contingent. And then you have 2 minutes to respond to the question. So we will turn it over to you. We're going to go by in alphabetical order, so we'll start with you with your opening statement, Councilmember Gray.
Thank you very much. I'm James Gray. I've been in counseling for a little over 4 years, if you live in District E. And I think I've done a good job of serving generally the city of New Orleans. I'm a public school grad, Morehouse College grad, joined the United States Marine Corps, served in the Republic of Vietnam as an infantry platoon commander, came back with the Harvard Law School, graduated, came to LSU, taught at LSU, the first African American to teach at LSU in the law school. I came to New Orleans about 40 years ago to practice law. I practiced law since that time. I've done a lot of things to practice law. But one of the notable things is I represented Haitian refugees who were coming here. And as a matter of fact, in jail, the first day I met one group, I saw a real little guy, and I said, he's too little to be in jail. I took him home and raised him. He calls me daddy today. His name is Pierre Charles. He's a taxi driver here in the city of New Orleans. I've coached kids in this city for 40 years, and I have done a variety of things. I'm the lawyer in the Tangible Parish, Quantity Parish, a couple other parishes, school desegregation suits fighting for African Americans. And believe it or not, those desegregation suits are still alive. And they're still arguing about stuff in court today. I'm told I have 30 seconds. As your city councilman, we passed the minimum wage. We took down the monuments. We reduced the jail population in Orleans Parish from 3,500 to 1,500. We put a DBA program in place that took African Americans from making 6% of the money in the city of New Orleans from the government to 30%. It's not the fair share, but it's a lot better than it's ever been before. The hospital that was built in my district for $140 million, African Americans got $42 million of that. Big share cover. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Cyndi Nguyen, and I'm the candidate for City Council District E. My ballot number is 81. I came back to New Orleans 18 years ago because I wanted to be closer to my grandparents and my parents. When I came back to New Orleans, I saw the community was still very disconnected. My family came to America in 1975. I was 5 years old at that time. When I recognized the separation, I immediately wanted to do something as a citizen. So I started a nonprofit organization called YIT. We're now 16 years old. The organization focused on bringing families together, making sure that we listen to our working parents. We created programs to make sure that our parents are able to continue to go to work, our children to have access to quality education, a safe haven where crime is high on the streets. Our senior citizens wanted a space in our community. We created that space because our senior citizens are very important to us. When our early Head Start program got wiped out when Katrina hit, I started a campaign to restore Head Start in our community. I'm very happy to say in 1 month, we're gonna be opening the first Head Start program in the Michoud community for 40 kids ages 3 and 4 years old. I've listened to the community for the past 16 years. I will continue to lend my ears to make sure that I engage and create space for individuals that have not had the opportunity to thrive in our community. I ask for your support and your vote. Thank you.
Thank you both. All right, we're going to get right into the agenda. Our first topic is related to the energy plans. As you know, the City Council is currently considering a proposal from Energy New Orleans for the construction of a new gas power plant at the old Michoud facility in the east. In February, Energy suspended its original application for the plant based on new information that shows the demand for electricity in New Orleans has decreased, and a plant of this size is not necessary to meet projected demand for electricity. Further, while Entergy customers have experienced 2,000 outages a year since 2011, and Entergy insists a new plant would address reliability issues, it has also acknowledged that the existing power infrastructure needs updates to truly address outage problems. Despite Entergy's own admissions and the withdrawal of the original proposal, Entergy's most recent proposal gives the City Council the option to choose the same plant that was originally proposed, but at a $16 million more than the original cost. First, we'd like to know your answer. Do you support, or are you in support of the proposal? And if so, justify its need. Councilmember Gray, you're first.
Well, first of all, the way the system is working right now, we're going through a process where we're gathering information, and part of that information, much of that information has not yet been gathered. It would be absolutely improper for me to say, I've decided how I'm going to vote and I don't have all the information in front of me. But I will say this loud and clear. Based on what I know, I'm very likely to support a plant inside Orleans Parish. And you need to understand, and I think there's been a lot of confusion about all of this. We right now are getting energy from somewhere, and we're piping it in. When we pipe that energy in, we pay for the cost of production, which means we pay the real estate taxes. For example, we have a lot of energy coming in from Arkansas. We pay real estate taxes in Arkansas. We pay the cost of operation in Arkansas. We pay for those wages in Arkansas. And the taxpayers here in Orleans Parish pay for that. And we pay for the transmission costs. If we got energy from a plant here in Orleans Parish, we would still pay the real estate tax, the cost of production, the wages. We wouldn't pay the transmission costs because there is no transmission cost because it's here in the parish. And in case of a storm that blew down lines, we would still have energy here close to us. We wouldn't be worried about a line that's running 300 miles from Arkansas or for some other distant place. So I think there's a lot to be looked at. I've not made a decision yet, but I hear so much of the argument against the plan that I think has not considered all the things we need to take a hard look at. I'm going to take a hard look at all the information and make a decision at the end of the day that I think is in the best interest of the people of Orleans Parish. And we can find out what that is when it comes, and we have to look at all the information. Thank you.
So, Councilmember Gray, you do not currently have a position. You are not saying yes or no to the
I am currently saying, based on the information I now have, I am very likely to vote for the plan. But I am obligated by law to listen to information that's going to come to us over the next couple of months. And I cannot have an official position without getting all that information in.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Ms. Nguyen.
Yes, so our organization has been involved in making sure that the information that Entergy provides to make sure that people fully understand the pros and cons about the project. I'll be honest to tell you, as a citizen, when I was looking to this, I was supporting the project. I thought I had all the information. But one thing I was very concerned about was basically the job creation, or the people in our district is going to be able to have access to the jobs or not. The second thing was the cost of the customer having to pay into the project and putting that liability on our senior citizens that are on fixed income. So I had many concerns. I was at a community meeting recently, and community was like, Cyndi, look at this project from a different lens. Look at this project from the capability of how our community is going to look like 20 years or 30 years. I honestly have to tell you, I sat back and I said, you know what? I didn't use that lens when I looked at this project. But I want to balance it out. I'm the type of person that I don't go to a meeting with the answer. I listen to people. I came to that meeting knowing that I was going to support the energy project. But I listened to the people. I hear what people were saying. We are very divided in this project. I have a lot of concern about this project. I believe it will be good if we could balance it out. There's a huge concern. I want to make sure that when customer pays into energy, how is it going to be protected? Are we going to, what happened in 15 years from now, 20 years from now, energy come back and say, well, we need to build something bigger, we need more investment. I want to end and say that energy is a good corporation. They've always been very supportive in community groups. But this is a project that we have to look at building our community for the future for our children. Is this project is going to be sustainable to make sure that our community continues to stay safe? And that's what I'm going to be looking at.
Ms. Nguyen, so your position is yes?
I don't live.
Your position is
yes. You're searching.
You're still searching.
Yeah, okay. Still listen to the people.
Okay. Question number two is related to children and families funding versus police. Children and families currently receive a mere 3% in the 2017 city budget. This includes North Sea, the Youth Work Summer Employment Program, and some funding for the Health Department. Public safety and preparedness represent 63% of our city budget. How do you respond to concerns that hiring more police officers and fewer activities for youth actually criminalizes young people? And what would you do differently to ensure a more balanced budget that supports young people's development and engagement?
Well, first of all, my response is that we ought not spend money on jails and police, and we all spend money on people and children. However, you need to be aware of a couple of things. First of all, we're not making the decisions on spending money right now. A federal judge has made that decision for us. We have a consent decree that dictates to us what we do, how we do it with the police and with the jail. And with the sheriff, well, with the sheriff is under the consent decree, and we're under the consent decree with the police, and we are being forced to fund both of those things without regard to what we would or would not like to do. Now, I remember a couple of years ago, I was not a city councilman when we entered into that consent decree, and everyone was celebrating in the streets like it was a good thing. And as a lawyer, I knew you don't enter into a consent decree until you know what the terms are. And we entered into that decree without knowing what it was going to cost us. We are now finding out that it's costing us an arm and a leg. However, when I came on the city council, NARD was making, they had a budget of about $4 million a year. It's about $16 million a year now. So we put a substantial amount of additional money into the libraries. I am very conscious of the need to put money on people, and that is where our future lies. The other thing is, your stats are a little misleading because some services are taken away from the city and given to other entities. If you really don't want to know how much we are spending on children, you have to look at what we're spending on schools. I mean, that has to be calculated in. If you calculate that in, all of a sudden the percentages change. I think we hear some catchphrases, we without thinking about it, without working through it, we jump to conclusions sometimes. I'm saying to you, I think about it, I work through it, and I'm working as hard as I can to increase the money we spend on our families and our children within the parameters that's available to us. Thank you.
Thank you.
When talking about crime, I always believe that when you create opportunities for people that don't have access to it, you would decrease crime. District E alone in the East, we have a viable 100 acres, the 416 property has sat there for 12 years. That property should be developed years ago, when you think about it, because that creates jobs for many of our young folks that are abandoned or neglected because there's no opportunity. We need to look at prevention programs. This morning, I spent time with the Strive New Orleans program. I sat in there in their pre-orientation class, amazed of the work that they're doing. That we should put more money into programs, prevention programs, that's going to really help our young folks. We need to create more jobs during the summer program. For the past 6 years, when I saw that there was a huge gap and there was no services for children 13 to 16 to prepare them for the workforce, we went out and created a program. I've been running teen camp to help prepare our young folks for the workforce, making sure that they understand the very basic skills. You need to show up for work in order to get paid. You need to make sure that you have good working ethics. And those are the stuff that we need to continue to invest in. I have 6 kids. My oldest is 24. I have triple sons that are 8. I care about the children. I care about our working parents. I've been a working parent for the past 24 years. And of course, I will work really hard to continue to listen to our working families, our children, engage in dialogue with them to make sure that we have funded programs that's going to help them to thrive in our city.
Thank you. This next question we'll ask Ms. Nguyen in the issue of fairness. We'll give you the opportunity to go first on this question. The question is related to economic development in rural in District E. In the 12 years since Hurricane Katrina, neither the New Orleans East Plaza Mall or Six Flags has returned, but at least a dozen dollar stores have popped up. Are you planning to attract mid to high paying jobs to District E, such as shopping malls and large corporations? And are there any moratoriums that you think should be lifted or should be instated, such as the moratorium on ABO?
Well, for sure, no more Dollar Tree, no more General Dollar, no more Family Dollar, no more Dollar, whatever. There's no more of that. But first of all,
We got to change the perception. We got to rebrand our community. We have been abandoned for the past 15 years. We have the space to create economic development. But there's a perception out there that is not good for District E. I lived in District E for buku years. And let me tell you guys need to come to District E and check us out. We are thriving. We're working really hard. But we need that leader that's going to create that space, that's going to take politics out of it. When I come to a business deal, I'm going to come with the people's agenda. I want to develop that 100 acres of land by the Six Flags. I drive by that piece of property 365 days, four times. Believe me, I am upset. But we got to rebrand the East. We got to change the perception. We got to remove blight. We have buku of blight in the East and in the Low Nine. People should not be living like that at all. Once we do that, and with the type of person I am, I create space for economic development. I bring the people to the table to make sure that we get the best jobs in our community. And we're going to enforce to make sure that our people get the job. We want to make sure that they get high wage paying jobs. We want to make sure that they are able to thrive in that company. We want to incorporate an incentive for housing. You work in the East, buy a house in the East. We're going to give you incentive. We got to spark up the East, the Low Nine, and Venetian out.
Well, first of all, as I said, I've been a councilman for 4.5 years. I got there 8 years after the flood. Incidentally, you asked about dollar stores. I have authorized one dollar store since I've been there. It's a dollar store on the shelf right next to the Domino's Pizza. Actually, some of my staffs questioned the authorization that I drove them to that pizza swamp and said, do you think we're better off with that pizza swamp there over the store that hires 11 people, pays $200,000 a year in taxes, and the church across the street, the suburban church, used the church for a hiring hall because they were enthused about the fact that they were going to get a store, get some of their members hired, and about the fact that the 40% of the people who live in New Orleans East and don't have a car need stores close to them. Now, I also talked to Lewis Larcell, the biggest developer in this part of the country, who has developed the Elmwood Shopping Center, the Manhattan, stuff on Manhattan on the West Bank, and I asked him, we are trying to develop the plaza. Are we hurt, harmed, or neutral by the fact that there's a dollar store somewhere else in New Orleans East? And this answer to me, and I think he knows more about developing plazas than anyone around, he says we are much better off with more retail in the area, regardless of the type, because retail follows retail. If you took, I don't know how many stores, say 14 stores, if you took those 14 stores away, and then you try to get some name brand store to come to the plaza, your job is much, much harder, because if there's a wilderness out there, they're not coming. You have to build a little at a time. Now, having said that, the next thing to go in the plaza is apply for building permits right now. We think we have in hand the plaza across Reed, and we're working on Six Flags as you see. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. In the spirit of time, because we're running a little tight, we're going to come to your closing comments. So you each have 2 minutes to close. And I'll just ask you to speak to what can the people of District E expect in the future under your leadership. Be reminded that the energy, the Power Coalition is concerned about the energy plant, the future of funding for children and families, and economic development. I'm going to start with Ms. Nguyen.
For the past 16 years, I've always been accessible to the community. Continue to engage across different ethnicities, different neighborhoods, different households. I will continue to do that as the next city council person. I've been accountable as a nonprofit executive director. I've listened to the people. I've lived in the community.
and I will continue to do so. I want to raise my children there. I will continue to shop and be part of the community. District E has been neglected for beaucoup of years, guys. Beaucoup of years. Things have to change. I'm the change agent. I understand what working families are going through. And the most important thing is that I understand the people of District E. I will continue to be engaged and create space and opportunity for everyone. I've worked hard and I will continue to work hard. If you live in District E, I ask that you consider me as your candidate of choice. If you don't live in District E, I ask and encourage you to pick up the phone, call your family and friends, because what doesn't happen in District E will affect the entire city of New Orleans. So I want to challenge you to help me to get this to the finish line on November the 18th. Again, my name is Cyndi Nguyen. My ballot number is 81. Thank you very much for spending your night with us today.
And so I served you in District E 8.5 years after the hurricane, the flood. When I came there, the hospital was a hope. The mayor had just fired the old board and started with a brand new board. We got a $140 million hospital out there. A lot of people said it would never happen. It did happen. We got Walmart out there. We got Big Lots out there. We got a lot of things over the last 4 years. In fact, I'd say not only was more stuff built in District E in the last 4.5 years than the 8 years previous to that, I would say the last 4 years is probably one of the best 4 years for construction in District E ever. Now, do we have a lot of stuff we need to do? Yes, there are tons of things we need to do. But we have the best developer in this part of the country working on the plaza. We have some plans, we're making progress, and I think we're gonna get some on the plaza. We have the best minds in the city talking to some big people right now about a deal in Six Flags. I think that will happen in the next couple of years. Now, some of the things that no one has even talked about, for example, I have been dealing with the port. What makes New Orleans a great city is not our food, our gumbo, and our music. What makes us a great city is that river and the canal system that we have in this city. We are still the largest bulk break port in America, and I am working on and have been working on getting stuff that offloads on Napoleon Avenue, come down to the east where we do have space, where you will repack the shipping, and hopefully where you will be assembling something, where you will have labor-intensive jobs that really don't necessarily require a lot of technology, a lot of expense. We will do well. The progress that we made will continue and it will accelerate because everything builds on what you have before. It was a struggle. And I hope you will look at the progress we've made, trust me on the progress in the future, and vote for me and give me another 4 years to continue the process. Thank you.
Thank you both. Let's thank both of our candidates for their engagement.